Hi all, today we are going to discuss about biased or percentage differential relay. So in the last class we have seen the basic differential relay. The basic disadvantage of basic differential relay is it will trip due to the imbalances in the CT secondary ratios due to their constructional differences, because exactly we cannot balance the characteristic of the CTs and both CTs will get saturated at different points of the fault currents. So because of that, the secondary currents will not be equal even for the external faults also. Because of that, difference of the current will pass through the relay and your relay will operate. And we have discussed there the better option for this one is go for the biased or percentage differential relay. And so this is the most extensively used form of differential relay out of this current differential relay. So let us see the basic construction of this. So this is a schematic arrangement for balanced beam type. So the beam is balanced with this, it will have two coils. One coil is the operating coil, another coil is the restraining coil. And the restraining coil is used for producing the restraining force. Operating coil is used for producing the operating force. You can see the operating coil is connected between the equipotential point of this first CT. It is connected through the operating coil. From the operating coil, the connected is connected to the restraining coil center point. And this restraining coil is connected across the two points of your CTs. Let us assume the current passing through the CTs, I am representing this, the current is equal to I1. So this side the current is equal to I2. Let us assume the currents are passing like this in the secondary side. So let us try to represent this equivalent one so that it will be more clear to you. So before proceeding, here you have to remember this spring is also producing the restraining force. And restraining coil also producing the restraining force. When the operating force is greater than the restraining force, so automatically this beam will move in this direction. So because of this, this contacts will move up and close your trip circuit. So this is the basic working principle of this. So let us see the equivalent circuit of this one. So the equivalent circuit I am drawing here, there are two CTs and this is my element to be protected. So now these CTs, these two points are connected together. I have connected those two points. Then you can see from this point, this is connected to the operating coil. So the operating coil is connected like this. So this is my operating coil. So now this operating coil secondary or second terminal is connected between a coil. That means a coil is there, it is connected in the center. So this operating coil is having a number of turns of NO. And this coil, it is connected in the center having a total number of turns are n. So this will be equal to n by 2 and this side it is equal to n by 2. This is connected in center. So now you can see one side of this coil is connected to CT1. So one side of this coil is connected to CT1 and the second side of this coil is connected to CT2. So it is connected to CT2 here. So this is my restraining coil. So let us take the example when the currents are passing through this one. This current I am taking as I1 and the current that is produced due to this one. So this current is equal to I2. Agree with me? So the same current I2 passes here and this I1 will return back from here. So we can tell that this I1 will pass like this. So this will pass through this one and return back through this one. That means through this one the current that is passing is equal to I1 and this I2, whatever the current is coming, this I2 comes like this. So I2 passes here, the I2 will return back like this and return back here. Or we can tell the net current that is passing through your operating coil will be difference of these two currents. This is I1 minus I2. Please remember all these are the phasors, not simple scalar quantities. So these are the phasor quantities. So it will take the phasor sum of these two currents. So in the operating coil, the current that is passing is equal to I1 minus I2 and the number of turns are N0. So the MMF of operating coil is equal to number of turns are N0 multiplied by I1 minus I2. Getting this one? So similar way, the MMF of restraining coil, this will be equal to n by 2 times of I1 plus n by 2 times of I2. So we can tell that n by 2 times of I1 plus I2. Agree with me? So n by 2 times I1 is passing and n by 2 times I2 is passing. So total MMF will be n by 2 times of I1 plus I2. So along with this one restraining, this spring also will apply the restraining force. So this restraining coil is used to avoid the problems that are arising due to differences in the CT ratios, particularly high values of the fault currents. So let us see how they are going to protect this one. So we know that when the MMF produced by the operating coil, that means N0 into I1 minus I2 is greater than the MMF produced by the restraining coil, that means N by 2 times of I1 plus I2, then your relay will trip. Agree with me? Because neglecting the effect of the spring, because spring effect will be there only for small values of the currents, that means the difference in the I1 minus I2 difference is small, otherwise its effect will be negligible. So if you are taking the characteristic curve, so characteristic curve I am drawing here, the curve will come something like this. So I am plotting between the average restraining current. Average restraining current will be equal to I1 plus I2 divided by 2. So this, when we multiply with the value of N, so you will get the actual value of MMF produced. So we can adjust the value of the MMF by adjusting the number of turns. Accordingly, the curve whatever we are getting now will shift, because the slope can change depending on the number of turns of these coils. So the second one is this differential operating currents, because the operating coil is carrying a current of I1 minus I2. Agree with me? So that is multiplied by the number of turns. Let us take the case when N0 is equal to N. So in that case, I am drawing the curve. So practically those values will be different, accordingly your slope will vary. So ideally speaking, it should have the characteristic like this, because when the value of I1 and I2 are increasing, so I1 plus I2 by 2 is increasing, and if the difference between I1 and I2 is increasing, then this operating torque is increased. That means the operating torque is produced only if there is a difference in current, and the restraining coil current, this torque will be always produced because it is the sum of I1 plus I2 divided by 2. So if difference between, let us assume the case I1 and I2 are very large values, and the difference, because very large values, the difference is less. So in that case, it will not operate, but they may be large values, but if the difference is large, that means if I1 minus I2 is greater than I1 plus I2 by 2, in that case, your relay will operate. So let us take the practical one. So there will be effect of the spring. So initially due to the spring, it will operate only if some minimum current is passing. So after that, your characteristics will resemble this one. So this is due to the effect of spring, and this region is called as the positive torque region, and this region we can call as a negative torque or negative force, whatever you take, because torque is a general term used, that is why I am using it. But in this case of balanced beam type, we call it as negative force region, whatever you tell it. So this is my operating characteristics. So from the operating characteristics, you can see, let us assume the fault has happened somewhere in the external place. That means there is some external fault. So here I am taking the case, there is an external fault. For the case of external fault, both the I1 will be equal to I2 in the primary side. So let us take it as I1 here. So there is I2 here. So some of the subscribers have questioned in the last class how I1 and small I1 can be in same direction. Actually, it depends on the dot notation. So I am taking the dot notation like that. Whenever the current passes in primary like this, the current leaves the dot in the secondary side. Getting this one? So that is why I am taking these current notations. So because of this I1, small I1 is produced, I2, small I2 is produced. Let us assume the core of your CT is saturated. That means this is saturated earlier when compared to the second CT. So there is a difference in the current. So that difference in current will pass through your operating coil and produces the operating torque, that is I1 minus I2. But the restraining force that is produced is proportional to the I1 plus I2, because as the currents are very large, so automatically the restraining force increases with the increase in the current. As the restraining force is increasing with the increase in current, so same thing we can observe here, it is having the rising characteristics. It is having the rising characteristic. The restraining force is increased with the increase in the current. That is why even if the cores get saturated because of that, even if some difference in the current is coming, that is not going to operate your relay. So the disadvantage of different CT ratios is solved here. So when the relay will operate? So let us take the case when the fault happens inside. So when the fault happens inside, the current I1, because the fault is supplied from I1, so I1 will be very high value, the current that is leaving will be either very less value or opposite direction the current can come. That means the current can come in the opposite direction. So if the current is coming in opposite direction, what will happen to the operating coil? This will become I1 plus I2. Agree with me? So this will be more, and restraining force will become equal to I1 minus I2 because current direction is reversed. So restraining torque is less than the operating torque, it will operate. Let us take the case it is fed from only one side. That means I1 is there, because of the internal fault the I2 is very less because I1 is dominating. Let us assume from here, for example, some 100 amperes is passing from here and the current that is leaving here is some 1 ampere because of the fault. So now this difference I1 minus I2 is very high compared to I1 plus I2 by 2. You can take the difference, 100 minus 1 is 99, and the restraining torque will be 100 plus 1, 101 divided by 2. So 101 divided by 2 is coming nearly 50, but the operating torque is more, so your relay will operate. Getting this one? So for the internal faults, your operating torque will be more and it will operate. For the external fault, they will not operate, even they are compensating the effect of saturation of your core. And let us try to compare the same thing with that of overcurrent relay. So I am trying to compare with the overcurrent relay. So I am drawing the characteristics here. So this is my average restraining current. So restraining current is I1 plus I2 divided by 2. You agree with me? So now this is my differential operating current. Differential operating current is the difference of these two. So this will be I1 minus I2. So now your overcurrent relay will operate some difference of I1 minus I2, because if you are using the simple overcurrent relay or simple relay, simple differential relay, so differential relay characteristics. This is overcurrent relay pickup value. So this overcurrent relay pickup value, let us assume it is set for X. So now what happens, practically due to the saturation of the CT, the difference between the currents of these CTs will start from some point once they get saturated. So after that, this difference in the currents will goes on increasing. So this is due to, this is a differential current due to CT unbalance, because the saturation is different. So that's why you can see here, when this point touches this point, so automatically your relay will operate. So your normal relay will operate, or normal differential relay will operate due to unbalances. Whereas if you go for our relay, that means the balanced or biased differential relay, in this relay the operating characteristics are like this. So this is my operating characteristics. So these are my operating characteristics for biased differential. So due to the biased differential relay, it will not affect due to differences in the CT unbalance. So this is the advantage of biased differential relay. So from this I am just summarizing the theory. So then we will proceed for the remaining things. From the operating characteristics, it can be observed that except for the effect of control spring at low currents, the ratio of differential operating current to the average restraining current is a fixed percentage. Because the ratio is a fixed percentage, we are getting a straight line, and I told you that slope of that straight line can be adjusted because MMF is proportional to current multiplied by the number of turns. When you are multiplying with the number of turns, so N naught is the number of turns for the operating coil and N is for the restraining coil. By adjusting the number of turns, the slope can be easily varied according to our requirement, how you want your relay to respond. So only that is the thing you have to remember, but the slope is always constant. Remember that one, for a fixed values of N naught and N. So the ratio of differential operating current to average restraining current is a fixed percentage. That's why this is called as a percentage differential relay. The name percentage differential relay came because of this. The ratio is a fixed percentage, ratio of the operating torque to the restraining torque is a fixed percentage. Then it is also called as a biased differential relay because the relay is restrained or biased against operating inaccurately under the fault conditions due to arising operating characteristics, due to rising operating characteristics. Because it is having the rising operating characteristics, because of that the coil is or the relay is restrained from operating under fault conditions due to unbalanced saturation of the CT. So those things I have already explained you here, right? So due to the unbalanced CT saturation regions, so this is the curve that is coming, it is operating at this point, whereas this bias differential relay is operating, not operating. So that's why this is called as biased or restrained differential relay. So that is the reason. So operating under the fault condition due to rising operating characteristics. So now there is a disadvantage of the balanced beam type. The disadvantage of the balanced beam type is, so the effect of transient currents due to DC offset is more in beam type relays. So this is what we have observed there. We had already discussed this overreach in our last class. So why the overreach is coming? That is coming because of these things only, because of the transient current. So same thing is the problem here. Transient current also produces torque that may maloperate your relay. So to avoid this problem, we will go for induction type bias differential relay. So induction type bias differential relay, I am going for the shaded ring type because this is the easiest possible type. Here you can see again the restraining element is having a coil having n turns. From the center the tapping is taken, that is connected to your operating coil, and these will be connected to the respect to CT. So CTs, whatever the connections are there on the top, they will be connected to the respective points. They will be connected to the respective points. So remaining things are same. I think remaining connections are not required. So let us see how this will operate. So I am showing the side view of this one. So if this is my disc, so the disc, this actually these things, so these things are kept here. So this is the here. So this is my shading ring. It is in the this side. So let us take this one. So here for this one, the shading ring is provided in this side, right? The shading ring is provided here. So we know that always the torque will be produced from unshaded region to the shaded region. You agree with me? Unshaded region to the shaded region. So in this case, the torque is produced in this direction. So this is my direction of the restraining torque. And in the case of operating torque is produced in this direction. So this is my operating torque. So the operating torque try to rotate in this direction and restraining torque try to rotate in the opposite direction. So when your operating torque is greater than TR, so then your resultant torque will come. So your resultant torque will be equal to the operating torque minus restraining torque. Getting this one? Because restraining torque is, or any torque is produced from unshaded portion to the shaded portion, because the shaded portion will be lagging behind the unshaded portion. So this we have already discussed in the induction type relay basics. So you can please refer there how the shading coil type relay works. Getting this one? So whenever this is rotated, so there will be a moving contact. So there will be a moving contact will be there. So this moving contacts will come and touch your the fixed contacts, and your relay will operate when this is rotated. This is the basic working principle of this. So the induction type relay, the advantage is, as a disc takes some time to rotate and close the contacts, so by the time if 2-3 cycles are passed, then it is immune to these transient conditions because of time lag, because it provides some time lag, so it will be immune due to the transient conditions. And second advantage of this relay is, by adjusting the position of this shading coil, whether you are moving towards the disc or moving away from the disc, so with that we can adjust the angle between the unshaded portion and the shaded portion. So we can easily adjust the torque that is produced. Either the operating torque or the restraining torque can be easily controlled depending on the constraint by moving or changing the position of this shading coil on this core. So that is the advantage of, second advantage of this induction type bias differential relay. I hope the bias differential relay concept is completely clear to you. If you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.